So it seems like Cargo Ash is the umbrella brand for a lot more going on.
Yeah.
And you're actually building it around yourself as a personality, which is very cool. It seems like the events management and the MC work is actually doing a lot, just building brand very actively. So yeah,
that's it. So a very good friend of mine named Nazir Lunat, he owns Race SA, which is Africa's premier top-end racing event. So they do half-mile and one-kilometer racing events. And it really is amazing to be a part of that. It's an honor and a privilege for me. So yeah, he contacted me a number of years back when he actually invited me to race at his event. And that's how I actually started at Race SA events. And then, you know, we knew each other for quite some time. And then he actually asked me, he said, hey, why don't you just come and MC, you know, at my events? Would you do that? So I'm like, you know, I don't actually do that anymore, but cool. I mean, for you, sure. You know, I'll make an exception. And it was the start of a good partnership, you know. And then I'm proud to be able to say that I've helped him out as well, you know, on race day, you know, which is very cool for me as well, because yeah, I kind of cut my teeth in straight line racing, yeah. Both legal and illegal. but yeah, it's a really great partnership. I'm glad to see you know, that it's going from strength to strength. And I mean, the caliber of cars at that event attracts is absolutely amazing. Supras, they do 300 plus on the half mile. You know, R35 GTRs, literally the fastest cars on the planet, both two wheels and four. Really, really amazing to be a part of that. And then I sit on the executive committee of the BMW Car Club of Cape Town, which I've been a part of for the best part of 6 years now. And I handle all of their track days and stuff like that at Killarney and all of the other activations that they the club embarks on, based on, you know, anything motorsport related. You know, so if they want to do skid pan or they want to do drifting, you know, or they want to do a track day or drag racing or stuff like that, I do that. And that's pretty much what that Car Guy is all about. It's all about facilitating whatever your needs are centered around hiring of cars, you know, for events and things like that, any kind of precision driving, facilitating permits and stuff like that for photo shoots. We obviously do videography and stuff like that with our partners, buying and selling of the cars, sourcing of the cars, tuning of the cars, anything that you need sort of motor related. I mean, there's more, maybe do a shameless plug here of my Instagram. It's that Car Guy Ash on Instagram.
Please do.
Yeah, you know, if you want to go have a look at some of the stuff we do, I think it will be pretty comprehensive there.
Yeah. Okay. No, I'll definitely put the links in the description. I think what's so attractive to me is the fact that you're doing quite a lot in the industry, but it's all out of experience and passion. It stems out of your experience and passion, like in the events management, hiring, selling of cars, or hiring, also the sourcing of cars. But the one thing that's always intriguing to me, listening to guys such as yourself doing a lot in the industry, is what gets you up in the morning? Like, what part of your job really grips you? Like, really, like, that's, if I could do only that one thing, it would be this. So what's that for you?
It's driving the cars.
Driving the cars.
Driving the cars. I mean, I'm fortunate enough to work for myself, although, you know, it has its pros and its cons. You know, if you earn a salary at the end of the month, you know, you put in X amount of work, whether you put in all of the effort or none of the effort, provided you show up, you still get the salary at the end of the month. When you work for yourself, yes, you have flexible hours and people think it's cool to be your own boss, but what you get out of it at the end of the month is directly proportionate to the effort that you put in.
Yeah.
You know, but like I said, getting up in the morning, what really motivates me is getting to drive the cars. And I mean, it's the cool part about it is that today's a TV shoot where I'll be driving a Jag and an Audi and, you know, drifting something. And then tomorrow it's tuning an M5. And the next day it's, you know, going to Killarney because you're facilitating a track day. You know, so it's all about, for me, it's a new motoring experience literally every day of the week. And that's really what gets me up in the morning, is that doing absolutely what I love. You know, and the experience changes almost each and every day.
I guess you also run less of a risk of running out of steam, or because you're not just doing one thing, but a variation. Every day is different. You know, every single event, it's different people, different cars you're doing now. And yeah, I think that's very cool, because I've seen a lot of people, motoring journalists I've known, tried to get into the industry, or maybe doing that for a few years, who just, you know, lack the passion after a few years, or they just do it because that is what pays the bills. But for you, of course, you started your own thing, it's a lot more than that. It's actually driven by the passion. You can actually go in, make a difference. It's not just doing processes.
Yeah, that's it. And if I could give any young guys out there who want to get involved in the industry some advice, is that, you know, it's all well and good to see the rosy outside. And if you're not 100% dead set and 100% passionate in getting involved in the motoring industry, don't.
Yeah.
And that's the best advice I think I can give you, because it seems like it's nice and it's fun, but you know, the money's not great if you want to get involved in any kind of sort of journalism, motoring journalism and stuff like it, unfortunately. But also there's a lot more competition, you know, than there used to be in every single facet of it, whether it's buying or selling cars, whether it's, you know, tuning. The tuning game is like, it's gone ridiculous now, you know, whereas like, you know, maybe 10 years ago, there were like four or five big brands that would be able to tune your car, you know, in the country. Now there's probably over 50 guys that you could easily find on Instagram, Facebook, Google that would be able to do the stuff for you, you know. And it used to be a very premium service. Yeah. And now it's good, the fact that, you know, it's become cheaper and more accessible. But then what it's done is that it's actually taken the quality of work out of the industry, in the sense that the guys who really do the really good stuff charge a premium for their product. But guys who are coming in are undercutting the market, making everything cheaper, and not necessarily delivering the same quality of product that used to be. And unfortunately, yeah, that's what's happening to the industry in pretty much all the facets of the industry, wherever it is. But if you want to get involved, then, you know, the key is to keep evolving, you know. So don't put all your eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
You know, like what I've done is that I've tried my best to diversify to the point where, you know, some of the work is seasonal, some of it isn't. But the key is to find balance, find a mix. And most importantly, is to keep the passion alive, because that's really what's going to keep you going.
Yeah. Keep the passion alive.
Yeah, so it was about turning the passion into something that's tangible, money, you know, sort of monetary wise.
Yeah. Okay. No, that's a good one. So speaking about passion, I want to enter into your cars and what you drive, your babies. So I want to, I guess, tell us about the cars you drive now, but also you're in the tuning business. What do you do to your cars, and what do you want your cars to be? When you're looking at a car to own for yourself, what are you looking at?
Well, the nice thing about what I do with the buying and selling and stuff like that is that I get to drive new cars all the time. You know, they keep changing, which is a lot of fun. I try not to get too attached.
Yeah.
Obviously, I still have my E36 M3, which is turning into a bit of a project car now. I really want to turbocharge it and, you know, just make it a really hardcore street car. One car that's also very close to my heart is the BMW 1M.
Yes.
It's got some really nice modifications, Akrapovic exhaust, you know, titanium exhaust, obviously a GTS tune on it, you know, full bolt-ons, really, really fun car. I think that's one of my favorite cars of all time, a modern classic. But as you can see, I mean, yeah, it's a lot of BMWs. I actually, funnily enough, I like a Honda S2000. I like that car as well. But with regards to cars, I mean, it's a very personal thing.
Yeah.
You know, there'll be a lot of guys that would like front-wheel drive cars, like a Renault Megane RS Trophy, which I think is a fantastic car as well, you know, for a front-wheel drive car. You get your all-wheel drive guys who like the Golf Rs, the RS3s, things like that, because they like to drive fast in a straight line. But for me, I'm a rear-wheel drive guy. Front engine, rear-wheel drive is pretty much what I want out of the cars, and you know, as close as possible to a 50-50 weight distribution, because it allows me to be sort of relatively quick in a straight line, if you know how to drive. You know, to kind of negate the advantage that the four-wheel drive cars have from launch. You can be very quick on a track, and you can have a lot of fun with the car, which is my biggest thing. So I want to be able to go sideways. I want to drift the car. You know, I want to get it out of shape. And, you know, it must be able to do all things sort of equally well and stand out in a few things that I hold, you know, sort of above the others in terms of the criteria when I look for a car. So, yeah, I mean, what I would love to own, yes, is... Dude, do we have enough time?
Yeah.
But yeah, I really also like the Alfa, the Giulia, the QV.
Yes, yes.
Ferrari-derived V6 twin-turbo, I mean, under the bonnet. As much as Alfa will tell you, or Ferrari will tell you, oh, it's an Alfa engine, it's pretty much a California T engine with two cylinders less. You know? The way that car sounds, the fact that a lot of the construction is carbon fiber, the way it handles, the fact that it's still got a little bit of quirks, like we mentioned earlier, being an Alfa. I love those things. I mean, the new McLarens also really, really nice.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, unbelievable cars. And then we can go like on and on to like the hypercars. And I mean, like, I'll try and give you my perfect five car garage.
Okay.
And this is like not an everyday story, but like it would be a 911 GT3 RS.
Yes. What generation?
So it would be the 991.2.
Yes. Okay.
All right. I love that one. It's got the 4-liter engine, the last of the Metzgers as well.
The Visac back.
Visac package has to be, and I take it in PDK, although I love manual.
Track that, driving.
Yeah. For track purposes, it would have to be the PDK. I want a Koenigsegg Agera RS. Absolutely love that car. Just the fact that it's raw and unbridled.
And it destroys other hypercars.
Yeah,
too.
And I mean, it destroys everything, but just the sound that it makes and the whole story and philosophy behind Koenigsegg is absolutely amazing and fascinating to me. You know, where one guy can actually start this company and build it to what he's actually done. So massive respect to that guy. The other one would be, I love a Cayman GT4.
Cayman GT4.
Yeah, love the Cayman GT4, naturally aspirated, manual, six-cylinder, sort of the baby Porsche. And I mean, like the Cayman for me, the only thing wrong with that car, the biggest problem it has is the 911.
Oh, yes.
Because even though we all know that the perfect layout for a sports car is mid-engine rear-wheel drive, I think a lot of people can agree on that. The performance would not be as good as a 911 simply because the GT4 cannot be faster than the 911.
Yeah.
And even though Porsche are very capable of making that car greater than the 911, they simply can't because of where it's positioned. And there's a company called Demand Motorsport, and they do...
I've seen this.
Yeah, they do a stroker engine for that car, and I think that is absolutely what just puts it over the top for me. So it has to be a Demand Motorsport engine GT4. The BMW 1M has to be in there as well, and I would definitely have an E30 M3.
E30 M3, yeah, that's a classic, that's the daddy.